this is your first time to the channel, consider subscribing, press the bell icon, and never miss an update. Hi all, I hope you are doing great. So in today's video, we are going to discuss about the much spoken about vehicle scrappage policy. So I'm going to keep my take on the vehicle scrappage policy very objective. While I'm recording this, the video, the policy is not out. However, there are many people speculating the policy contents. And to be honest, like every other two-stroke owner, I am worried as well. So I'm going to list out the policy highlights which the media has reported so far, and I am going to talk about the perceived advantages and disadvantages. So my aim by making this video is not to criticize the policy or any other policy by the current regime. My take about this is very objective, and my focus would be to talk about the problems, the perceived advantages and the disadvantages. Okay, so I'm going to contradict myself by saying this particular statement, that I'm not going to criticize the current regime, but this policy, like any other policy of the government, is hailed as historic. So I'm going to stop at that. I'm not going to get into the political aspect of things, but this is claimed to have been very successful in countries like US, UK and other big countries, and it is envisaged to bring a big relief to the auto sector. For the last couple of years, the auto sales have been decreasing, and the main reason for the decline is attributed to the decline of demand due to people depending on the used auto market. Personally, I don't think the person who linked the two has the slightest idea of what he or she is talking about. Every industry actually is going through a disruption. Okay, so what does disruption mean? The biggest example of disruption was the IT BPO boom which India had several years ago, and which led to several job losses in countries like US and UK, and creation of hundreds of thousands of jobs in India. Okay, the auto sector also went through a disruption like that. The key factor is the cost of ownership. Obviously, the government has increased the cost of fuel like nobody's business. Okay, they deregulated diesel prices and have increased the third party insurance rates. So let me give you an example. Okay, in 2013, the lowest premium available, actually 2016, the lowest premium available for cruise with comprehensive insurance was around 12,000. Okay, today, which is the day I am actually recording this video, the insurance premium is around 12,000 for third party. Okay, so people started realizing the benefit of using Ola and Uber. Specifically, they understood that the congested city traffic, especially in cities like Bangalore, would not give them any driving pleasure, so it is better to be driving around. The prices are so competitive that the thought of buying cars became a big financial burden, and taking a cab was a lot cheaper and a huge convenience. Okay, so people started taking cabs. Then came those subscription based cars, so it became even more lucrative to rent one than own one. These disruptions hit the market hard, but you might still think, the car are still getting sold, then where is the problem? So here is the twist. Most of the rentals are base models, okay, and the rental companies buy in bulk, so they get great deals. But wait, where is the actual problem here? Still cars are being sold. Okay, so another major problem especially faced by the auto sector is tax terrorism. Okay, you would be shocked when you hear almost 50% of price a consumer pays for an SUV like a Toyota Fortuner is tax. You pay tax on the car, then you pay road tax, then you pay tax on every single thing you buy, insurance, accessories, this says, that says. To be honest, it's a mess. Imagine where the total tax on a 44 lakh SUV is almost 22 lakhs. Who will consider buying a new car? Majority of the auto sector is dependent on reliable vehicles. Imagine when the government reduces the fitness of cars from 15 years to 10 years, the behavior of the buyer changes. They don't want to get something that will depreciate like there is no tomorrow and won't be useful after 10 years. At least this holds true for me. There are only a few people, to be honest, who buy a luxury category vehicle brand new from the showroom. For them, keeping a car beyond 2 to 3 years is not in line with the status statement that they want to set. So this is then bought by an aspiring person who slowly wants to graduate to the next segment. And buying a used car is going to bring value, which is unmatched. This is the category who will keep the vehicle longer. I'm talking about the second category. Okay. Though the first group of individuals who actually buy these luxury cars from the showroom suffer the maximum depreciation, but with the new policy, the second segment will also get hit very badly. This will prevent from them going for these vehicles. Okay. This will kill the resale value further. Anyone who feels insecure will hold his purchases, and that's how economy functions. Okay, people who are confident usually open their wallets. People who are not confident, they just close their wallets and stay put. Okay. So, back to the scrappage policy. So, we are going to talk about advantage. Okay. This will ensure fuel efficient vehicles ply the roads, which is like, you know, all those Euro 1, Euro 2 or pre-Bharat 6 vehicles are, you know, slowly phased out of the road. And this is an important bit for you, because this is where the two strokes also come in. Okay. So it is alleged that this will boost the vehicle sales. So we have covered that sales bit just a couple of minutes back. And, you know, just because there is a scrappage policy, there is going to be absolutely no, you know, boost in the vehicle sales. See, this boost actually came in foreign countries because of two reasons. One is the government actually subsidized buying a new car. They paid an incentive to the customer. So government actually opened their wallets and they paid car makers so that they could create vehicles which are subsidized. Okay, that's how subsidy works. And the consumer also got some money out of his old clunker. Okay, so that's how they are called. So to give you an example, a Mitsubishi Lancer or a Ambassador actually fetches somewhere close to 10,000 rupees when you weigh the vehicle as scrap. So technically speaking, that is the most money you are going to get if you are going to scrap your vehicle. You will get a certificate and obviously you will get, let's say, a credit. So that is a 10,000 rupee credit. So person who is buying a new car might not really enjoy this 10,000 rupees. Okay. So let's park this point for a second and let's move on to the other advantage. This will create fresh jobs. So they are envisaging that this move will create new jobs in the scrapping sector. Okay. This will take the polluting vehicles off the road. This is something that we have already spoken about. But then, you know, we primarily focused on the fuel efficiency part in the previous points. And this is the pollution part. Okay. So this will reduce carbon emissions overall. Okay. Cost savings to the consumer by producing scrappage certificates. So these are the advantage which the government envisages. So I'm going to now start the disadvantage, which the list is endless. Okay. My First question is, where are the scrap yards where the vehicle would be scrapped? Okay, so there is absolutely no scrap yards now, except for, like, let's say in the city that I live in Trivandrum, there are actually two scrap yards. Okay, one is huge, the second one is a little smaller. So these scrap yards basically sell used car parts. That's how they make their money, and whatever that cannot be salvaged is sold for its weight in metal. So if any of you has visited these scrap yards, you will see the kind of environmental damage these scrap yards cause. Like, you know, you will see oil flowing all over the, you know, flowing right into the mud. Then you have, you know, various toxic chemicals, like, you know, the battery fluids, the radiator coolant, and all those other oils which are different from engine oils flowing into the ground. So this actually causes a bigger environmental threat. And then this is done very manually. Like, you know, you will see a guy with a chisel and a hammer who will take these parts out. So that doesn't, you know, take away the carbon emission. It actually adds to the carbon footprint of, you know, going ahead and scrapping a vehicle. Okay, so there are obviously no scrap yards in India, at least I know of, where these vehicles are scrapped scientifically. Okay, so there is another point which is said as an advantage, which is that the raw material production for these vehicles will be readily available, like, you know, all those copper, aluminium, then, you know, steel, which is reclaimed from old vehicles, can be used for new vehicles. Okay, so this is where things get a little funny. I don't know how many of you actually know, but India has two of the biggest shipping wrecking yards in the entire world. Okay, one is in Gujarat near the Kandla port, and the second one is actually in the Bay of Bengal. Okay, it's somewhere in Bengal. Actually, I don't know exactly the location, but it is in the Bay of Bengal. So if you search in Google for the images of these shipwrecking yards, and let me see if I can post some, you will see how much or the kind of pollution these are creating. And breaking a ship is definitely better than breaking, let's say, 10,000, 20,000 cars. And the amount of raw material that this ships produce is much more than what these 10,000 cars can produce. And now the funny part is, everything, you know, trains, railway tracks, signpost, everything that the government actually uses for its infrastructure, like, you know, electric poles, then there are signal posts, those things are actually sold as scrap, and those are recycled in India. So where is all these material going to? So this is another stupid thing, you know. It is like finding let's say advantages in things which already are proving out to be a big problem. So scrapping in India actually creates more pollution. Okay, and though this are unorganized sectors, but you must have now understood that India has the biggest metal scrap recycling business. Okay, so there was a time when scrap metal used to come from various countries and used to get processed in India. So, you know, it goes without saying, these unscientific dismantling and, you know, recycling creates more carbon emission, because what is done, you know, these metals are melted back and they are, you know, created into various forms, like, you know, sheets, then you have solid metal bars which can be used by other factories. So this is not something that doesn't happen in India, or is new, or is untapped in India, like they would like to say, but this happens. Okay, Another thing which is worth noting, and this actually concerns me a lot, okay? We are going through a pandemic right now, okay? People don't have any money, okay? The situation is so bad that I have seen people selling bakery items like, you know, the small ovens, the display shelves on OLX for like 5,000 to 7,000 rupees, you know, and maybe the price is around that, but it is sad to see those kind of things. You know, that was somebody's dream. He or she thought at some point that he will make big by making bakery items. You know, specifically in Trivandrum, if you go out for a drive, you will see, you know, mushrooms of people selling biryani out of their cars. You have people selling other food articles on their cars. You have ladies coming and sitting and selling, you know, vegetable produce which is made in their, I mean, which is grown in their backyard on the roads. So that is the kind of situation, you know. So the government really needs to understand, just because you have cooked something doesn't mean that it will bring advantages. So just because, you know, the government has created a policy, that doesn't mean that it will bring the advantage which the government actually envisaged. The timing of the policy could actually take the auto sector in a tailspin right now, to be very honest, okay? With the current situation, the government should actually focus on giving the sector a revival package through tax holidays. People have a huge challenge commuting these days, okay? Especially with the, you know, social distancing and the number of people who can sit in a bus or let's say an auto. It's a huge challenge, and most of the vehicles are also pretty less. You won't see the number of buses proportionately getting increased to the number of people who are traveling, okay? So commuting has become a challenge, and if the loan interest rates reduce and if the common man has access to cheaper loans and cheaper cars, the sector will revive, okay? Just imagine if, let's say, a Fortuner doesn't cost 44 lakhs anymore and costs more like 23-24, people will definitely go for vehicles, and proportionately if you decrease the price of other vehicles, people will go, okay? So the right now with the pandemic, the public transport is out of question for many people, right? So, you know, the government should actually give a tax holiday to people and see that the sales would climb. Right now the government should say, okay, we understand that, you know, there is a pandemic, you guys should, you know, stop spending the kind of tax that you have been spending, and you should actually get a tax benefit now by reduction of income taxes, reduction of taxes on purchases. So that would bring that confidence back into the common man, which he has lost in the past 6 years of this current regime. Okay, so, you know, the government should actually stop chasing fiscal targets. I know, you know, you might be thinking, okay, this guy all of a sudden is an economic you know, guru, he knows everything about economics and he's talking as if, you know, he knows, he understands everything. You have to understand one simple thing. The central government needs to understand the pandemic is being fought by the state governments at a state level. So if everything you buy has a huge chunk of the central government revenue, you know, tied into it, the state governments are struggling right now. The central government hasn't paid the, you know, the tax dues which it has to, the GST tax dues which it has to pay the state governments, and things are very bad, and that actually percolates to the common man. You know, the government doesn't have money to pay salary, you know, that reduces spending by these people who are dependent on salaries. Things, you know, become scarce because, you know, people stop buying things in bulk because they cannot sell. So this is a trickling effect. So you have to understand, you know, by you I'm saying, the government has to understand that this is a very bad time to come up with a policy like this. You know, this is not gonna help anybody. And, you know, let me also tell you very honestly, even if this policy comes, it's a voluntary thing. Okay, so nobody is going to come to your house and, you know, take your vehicles away. So as far as our bikes go, they will live with us in our living rooms and bedrooms. No one can really take them away from us. And if they have to, then they have to pry open our dead claws to take our bikes out of our hands. So, you know, I hope this video brings some, you know, clarity amongst the numerous videos that are just creating more fear in people. So this policy again is voluntary. It's not going to affect you guys, but at the same time, with this regime, the confidence is very low amongst people. So though this is very scary for a lot of us, I don't think, you know, stupid things like this are gonna happen. You know, most likely what is going to happen is, if they are going to bring a scrappish policy like this, you will have a lot of people who will go away from the legitimate testing of the vehicles. There are a lot of people right now who are using their vehicles without insurance, they use their vehicles without pollution, they use their vehicle without fitness. So bringing a rule like this is gonna create a lot of more such people. So I hope some sense prevails in the government and they don't come up with anything stupid. Most of the advantage which they have listed, like, you know, creating jobs, going ahead and creating you know, a raw material heaven, is all, you know, I don't want to use that word, but it's all bull. So basically, this is not going to bring more advantage like they thought. See, in the foreign countries, the government did a lot of things. They opened their wallet, they went ahead and they gave subsidy to people. And also at that time, there was no such disruption in the auto industry happening like what you're having now. You know, that disruption coupled with the pandemic, coupled with, you know, tax terrorism, coupled with increasing fuel prices. It is a lot of factors that has actually gone ahead and broken the back of the auto sector. So just bringing a scrappage policy is not going to revive the auto sector. So that is my personal view. I hope you enjoyed the video. If you did, please like, share and subscribe. If you want to comment, please go ahead and comment in the comment section, and stay tuned for the next one. Bye-bye.